We're starting with the second chapter of our book, that is a snapshot. The chapter is the address. Now, when we talk about, you know, like when you meet someone or people want to know you, after knowing your name, right? And if they want more information about you, you tell them about your address. So address is a very important identity that we have. And yes, which is your favorite address? Of the school address? Okay, any other address? Yes? Your own address, right? Our home, when we talk about, yeah, that is the most favorite address and the place where we feel the most comfortable and secure. That is our home, right? And if there ever happened a situation in your life that you had to forget the address, what would it be like? When you shift to a new place, right? Then you have to, right? Yes. Or it could be maybe because of certain circumstances that have happened in your life. So you have to forget that address and you have to move on to a new one. Okay. Now, this chapter, it talks about war and its consequences. When we discuss about war, we talk about loss of property. We talk about financial losses. We talk about losses in terms of number of lives, right? So many soldiers and so many civilians and so much of, you know, like, yes, money was spent and buildings destroyed and everything. One thing that we don't generally discuss is about the effect of war on the lives of people. Right? So when you talk about wars, yes, if our home gets destroyed, if things go well, if we are strong enough, we'll rebuild it. Right? Yes? If you've suffered a loss in your business, you'll work hard and you'll try to make up for that loss and come back to your comfortable position. But what about the near and dear ones that you lose? How do you recover from that loss? One day you are with your family, very happy, very secure, and all of a sudden something happens that within days you are separated from your family and you are left all alone in this world. Nobody talks about that, right? Now this chapter, it talks about that. It talks about the consequences of war, the effect of war on human lives, and how wars, they affect our behavior. Now we're talking about World War I and we're talking about World War II also. So when you talk about World War I, we talk about Hitler and yes, Germany and the Nazis and all. We talk about the German concentration camps. Yes, we talk about the Jews being targeted. Do you remember you've done in your social sciences also, right? Yes? Yeah. Now here in this story, what we are going to read about, it is that. So the narrator here, she belongs to a Jewish family, right? And so when this world war began, when Germany started occupying the other countries, and of course, yes, how the Jews, they were targeted in particular. And first off, it was only from Germany, then it was from all European countries, and they were taken away and sent to concentration camps, right? So irrespective of age, gender, profession, whatever, right? And so much of hatred, it's not a nice thing. So what happened was, this family was a Jewish family. As the rumors of the war started spreading, so they, people, you know, like here, they decided, yes, many of them, they shifted to other places. Many of them made arrangements that they could go into hiding, right? Many were not fast enough and they lost their family to the concentration camps. Now here in this, this is what happens exactly. So the narrator, her mother had a friend. Of course, that friend showed up very conveniently before the war. She realized this is a Jewish family. They are in danger And all of a sudden, she developed a friendship with them. And what did she start doing? Whenever she would come, she would take a bag full of or a suitcase of their belongings and take them to her own house, right? And one day when the narrator, she came back, right? And she saw that lady taking a big suitcase from their home. And the mother said that she's going to keep them safe for us. Because if the situation goes very bad, we might have to vacate our house. And if we vacate our house, there might be robbers and things and people might take away our belongings. So she's going to keep them safe for us. And when things get better, she will return them. Right? This is what she told her daughter. Okay? And she also gave her an address that if after the war we survive and we need to take our belongings back, this is the address you have to remember. So what is the address? The address is of that lady who had taken their belongings, right? Promising that when the situation is better, when the time is better, I will return them. Okay, right? So we have read, you know, I think so much has been discussed about what happens during war. People we trust, they change. They might be the ones who go and inform about you to the forces, right? They might be the one who will, you know, put your life in danger to save theirs. Right? Yeah, so it is there. As it is said, our true character, it is revealed in adversity. It's in tough times. How true do you remain? How loyal do you remain? How helpful do you remain? Right? And yes, it was because that fear had been created, that division had been made. The forces had created such a fear in the minds of the people that if you give shelter to the Nazis, if you help them, then we will be taking action against you also. So people were not ready also, right? So this is the story after the war. What has happened? The narrator, she is the only survivor from her family. Her family members, they've been lost. She's lost them in the war. And she has come back, the sole survivor. And when things did start coming back to normal, although right after war, it takes a long for normalcy to return. What did she do? She remembered the address her mother told her, right? So she went over there to bring back her belongings so that I can start my life with the memories of my near and dear ones, right? See here, like when you were children, and even now you're not very big and grown up, but yes, so when you were children, you had a lot of toys. And on every occasion or whenever you would get a new toy, and that new toy would become your new favorite, and you might be ignoring the others. But when your cousins or your friends, they came to play over, you might not have touched those toys in 10 days or weeks and months. But if they wanted to play, would you let them touch them? We were so possessive, right? So this is how we feel about our belongings. Some of us are there very caring. You know, yeah, you can. But some of us are not. No, don't touch my thing. This is my thing. This is my thing and my thing. And we'll just catch hold of everything and not give anything at all, right? So you might have done that. Many of you might have done that. It's very common to see your children behave like this. Now, if someone borrows something from you, right? They take your favorite dress, right? And your friend says, see, I like this dress of yours and I want to wear it for a function. So can I wear it? Would you lend it? First of all, in your heart of hearts, you say a big no. I don't want to, right? But then you say, she's my best friend and she's never asked me anything before. So let me give it to her. And when your friend returns your dress, do you expect your dress to be in the same condition as you gave it? Yes, you don't expect a tear or you don't want it to be in the bad condition, right? Remember the story necklace? Yes, you remember the story necklace? Yeah, you remember necklace and how she lost that necklace and her whole life was changed because of one. So you want here, and even if you take something, you know, like from someone, you want that, yes. right? And if you look, those of you who are in your rooms, just take a look at the things in your rooms. So whether it is a book or a toy or maybe, you know, any kind of artifact which is there, a photograph which is there, everything has a special memory, right? So when it comes for Diwali cleaning time, you know, when you take out things from our home, right, or people like me might keep half the things back. Oh, I like this, I can't give this away, isn't it? Right? So we have special memories with so many things, and we don't want to give them away. But here in this case, what happened? The lady, she took the belongings. She was supposed to take care of them. And she was so sure that none of them is going to return back after the war. What did she start doing? She started using those things. Right? So when I use somebody's things here, naturally, I might not have the knowledge of the importance of that, right? So if I give someone my book, I'm going to say, please take good care of it. This book is very special. It was given on a special occasion and all, because I have special memories with it. The other person might tear that book and return it. Oh, I'm so sorry. You know, like my cousin came and he pulled that book apart, and your heart is also going to break in so many pieces. Why that child could not take care of my belongings? So we all have special memories, right? And with everything that is associated with it, right? So here, this is what this chapter about. Why did the girl go over there to the address? She wanted to bring her mother's belongings. She was alone after the war, and she wanted to make a new beginning, a new start. What better way than to start by bringing back her mother's belongings? So she thought at least it will make that pain of the loss which she's going through. She's lost her near and dear ones. She's lost her family. So it would make it more bearable. Okay, right? So what happens that at the end, she decides to forget the address. This is what the story is about. Okay, right? It is about war. How after war, we do not think about the families who have lost their near and dear ones, the emotional losses and pains and things that they go through, right? We are more concerned about property and money and buildings and things. We are not worried about that, how people are going to restart their lives after the loss of their near and dear ones. Then it is about, if you made a promise to someone, how can you easily break it? It's about how people change, right? Okay, so let's start with the reading of this chapter. Yes, and what has happened to the attendance of the students, right? Yes, Isha, I'm going to share me the attendance. Isha is there? Yes, Isha is there. So let's have a look at the chapter. So the address is a short story. Margot Minko is the writer. And this story is a poignant account of a daughter who goes in search of her mother's belonging after the war in Holland. So many Jews, they migrated, they went over there, right, to escape from the wrath of Hitler. If you remember The Diary of a Young Girl, Anne Frank, yes. When she finds them, the objects evoke memories of her earlier life, life before the war. However, she decides to leave them all behind and resolves to move on. What is it that makes her move on? That she needs to forget those things. Do you still know me? I asked. The woman looked at me searchingly. She had opened the door a chink. I came closer and stood on the step. Chink means just a little bit, right? So like when strangers come, so we don't open the door, whole door, you know, like welcome to my house. So we are a little cautious. So this lady, she just opened the door a little bit. No, I don't know you. I am Mrs. S's daughter, right? So her mother has been referred to as Mrs. S. She held her hand on the door as though she wanted to prevent it opening any further. So she's kept her hand on the door. She does not want to open it anymore. Her face gave absolutely no sign of recognition. She kept staring at me in silence. So she said, I'm Mrs. S's daughter. And that lady kept on looking at her, that I don't recognize you, right? Perhaps I was mistaken. I thought perhaps it isn't her. I had seen her only once, fleetingly, and that was years ago. It was most probable that I had rung the wrong bell. I came to the wrong address. I came to the wrong house. So I had seen this lady many years ago after the war. Now she's come back. The woman let go of the door and stepped to the side. She was wearing my mother's green knitted cardigan. Now she's sure I've come to the right address, because what did she see the lady wearing? Her mother's cardigan. The wooden buttons were rather pale from washing. So it's not that, yes, she's worn it quite often. The buttons have become pale from washing. She saw that I was looking at the cardigan and half hid herself again behind the door. So she hid herself so that she would not recognize the cardigan. But I knew now that I was right. Now I've come to the right address. So what is the address? What is the context of the address? The address which the narrator's mother had told her to remember. Has she come to the right address? Yes. Earlier, she's a little doubtful. But when she looks at the lady and she sees that the lady is wearing her mother's cardigan, she becomes absolutely sure, I've come to the right address. Well, you knew my mother? I asked, have you come back? Said the woman, I thought no one had come back. Why did she say that? I thought no one had come back. Yes, because of the war, and she had never expected them to come back. Only me, only I have come, nobody else. A door opened and closed in the passage behind her. A musty smell emerged. So now the door opened in the passage, right? One of the rooms. A musty smell, you know, that smell of dampness when you don't allow enough sunlight, or you don't open the doors and windows long enough. So that musty smell emerged. I regret I cannot do anything for you. I've come here specially on the train. I wanted to talk to you for a moment. So she says, I've come here specially, right? I traveled a long distance and I want to talk to you for a moment. It's not convenient for me now, said the woman. I can't see you another time. So right now I can't see you, so maybe some other time. She nodded and cautiously closed the door as though no one inside the house should be disturbed. So she's very cautious, very quietly she's closed the door. Nobody should hear, maybe that is why. I stood where I was on the step. The curtain in front of the bay window, the window towards the door, right, moved. Someone stared at me and would then have asked what I wanted. Oh, nothing, the woman would have said. It was nothing, right? So, of course, so she's imagining this conversation. So somewhere, like, she felt that someone is looking outside, right, from the window. And if somebody asked the lady that who was there outside, she would have said no one, right? It was nothing, right? Maybe someone, the wrong person has come. I stood, I looked at the nameplate again. Darling, it said, in black letters on white enamel. And on the jamb, a bit higher, the number 46. So like you have your nameplates outside your home or not, right? So the address is there written, or the number there, the street number there written. So what is the address? The address is 46 Markany Street. The lady's name is Mrs. Darling. Okay. So what are the things you have to remember? What is the address? Where has she reached? Markany Streets. 46 Markany Street. She's absolutely sure this is what her mother had told her. What is the lady's name? Mrs. Darling. And she refers to herself as Mrs. S's daughter. Okay? Right? Is it clear till here? As I walked slowly back to the station, I thought about my mother, who had given me the address years ago. It had been in the first half of the war. I was home for a few days, and it struck me immediately that something or the other about the rooms had changed. Although we think that children are not very attentive about what is there in the house, but when many things start going missing, you also realize, all right, you've changed something. Something is missing. Where is this, that, right? So she noticed that there were a few things missing. My mother was surprised I should have noticed so quickly. So mothers don't expect us to notice things. Then she told me about Mrs. Darling. I had never heard of her, but apparently she was an old acquaintance of my mother, whom she hadn't seen for years. She knew this lady, but they had not met for years. She had suddenly turned up and renewed their contact. Why do you think she renewed the contact? To take the belongings, right? So it was not mother, but it was a lady who renewed the contact, right? Because she knew it was a Jewish family, right? Their lives were in danger. They would be vacating their homes. So before all the looting and plundering takes place, so let me take the things, right? So she, do you think her intentions were good? No, her intentions were not good. She said, yes, I will be taking care of them. I'll return them after the war is over. But we have seen that. She was wearing the cardigan, right? She had no intention of returning the things. Okay? Yes. Right. Now, every time she leaves here, she takes something home with her, said my mother. She took all the table silver in one go. What is the table silver? The cutlery we use. What is the cutlery? What is cutlery? The knives and forks, that is cutlery. What is crockery? Crockery is your dinner set. That is your plates and your bowls and all, right? So what is cutlery? Cutlery, the knives and forks, right? And they were silver, made of silver. That means they were a well of family, yes. She took all the table silver in one go, and then the antique plates that hung there. What is antique? What is antique? Old, but valuable. Okay? So antique things here. The older things, they have more value. So you have your antique paintings. We have antique statues and all, right? So they're valuable. So even she had these antique plates, which were there, and they were for decorative purpose. They were not for eating. Okay? She had trouble lugging those large vases, and I'm worried she got a crick in her back from the crockery. She had a problem in pulling that suitcase, right? And it seemed that she might have hurt her back also because of the crockery. There was so much, right? It was not a small amount. My mother shook her head pityingly. I would never have dared ask her. She suggested it to me herself. She even insisted. She wanted to save all my nice things. If we have to leave here, we shall lose everything, she says. How helpful, right? So the lady appears to be quite helpful, quite kind, quite understanding. But does she turn out to be? No. Was she helping her? No. Why was she taking those things? For herself. Did she have any intention of returning them? No, if she had, she would not have started using her belongings. She would not have started, okay? So we'll stop here and we continue on next week. We continue, okay?